Next week sees the start of Barry Callebaut's Treat Tomorrow event. We catch up with Baz Smith to discuss how the online showcase will aim to shape the future development of confectionery, as well as examine how the business has reacted to the pandemic over the past 12 months. We also look ahead to the coming months just to see what some of the major challenges will be as the industry looks to recover from the COVID crisis.
It's a collaborative journey we have initiated, and what we will kick off basically on the 28th of April. And we feel that COVID-19 basically has had a massive impact on the whole globe, but propelled the change of some things which were already in the making. And it accelerated basically the change of these some of the consumer desires and needs. Chocolate and chocolate indulgence has to basically adapt itself to be a relevant category for the future. And what do we mean with it? A consumer is much more caring about the person and environmental health. And environmental health, I don't only mean the environment being nature, but as well the environment of human beings you're part of. It can be communities and communities next door, but communities 10,000 kilometers from your door. And obviously, then you talk about your whole supply chain and where you source ingredients in our case. But equally so, the partners you work with very closely. Now, the consumer does care more about these kind of aspects, and that has its implications to their attitudes to life. That has its implications to the food and drinks they prefer. Yeah, and chocolate indulgence being part of the food and drinks they prefer, which is preferred across the globe, we need to be mindful that some other things are expected now more than ever. Now, we as Barry Callebaut, being, as you know, the biggest chocolate maker in the world, feels obliged to lead this journey and to lead this change. And I sometimes make the comparison with the automotive industry, like Mr. Musk initiated 10 plus years, a different kind of car with a different kind of engine and a different kind of fuel. Now more and more car brands jump on the same wagon to make sure that they are fit for a fossil fuel-free mobility game. Now, in our context, what does this imply? What does it mean that consumer attitudes change? What does it mean that health and environmental care are more and more important? What does it mean for the chocolate consumers want to buy? And for example, as well, and like we know, there's almost a one-on-one correlation between obesity and how severely impacted you are by COVID. Now, we know that the more sugar you consume, the more likelihood you will have that you will gain weight. How is chocolate addressing this? And if we don't address it proactively, then for sure governments will act. That's what we have seen in the UK a couple of months ago, in the midst of the COVID pandemic, that Boris Johnson and his cabinet announced no advertising to kids anymore about sugar-heavy products. Moreover, hey, industry, we agreed with each other that by 2020, X percent, the sugar levels of your product should be X percent less. But you didn't make it happen. Be aware that there might be some policies on your shoulders if you don't act now. Now, we feel that we have to start this conversation with the industry. We already did. 10 plus years ago, we started with our first sugar-reduced solutions. But what is the next generation of this kind of propositions? That's one aspect. The whole aspect of people being more and more concerned about the meat consumption, because we know heavy meat consumption has a negative impact on the environment, specifically nature. What are the implications for chocolate indulgence if you think about milk chocolate, the most beloved chocolate category across the world? Two-thirds of the global annual chocolate consumption is made out of milk chocolate. Yeah, an important substance and ingredient is milk. But if consumers want to have less animal produce in their products they consume, what are the implications for chocolate and chocolate indulgence? Now, there are several aspects we feel we need to start talking about in more actively, but as well with a horizon which is ahead of us, not just the next year, more the tactical discussions, more the strategic discussions. And hence we thought, and we raised ourselves the question, how should we treat the treats of tomorrow differently? And then therefore Treat Tomorrow is born, to shape chocolate indulgence for the decade to come, to shape chocolate indulgence, caring for personal and environmental health. So a collaborative journey, not a campaign, which will be kicked off on the 28th of April in a 2 days way.
And I understand there's going to be a series of 5 mini series as part of that. Can you explain a little bit more about how that will actually work?
Yes, I can. So you might remember the years 20 years ago when we were still at school. There were the years of that product brochures, the physical product brochures, were turned into digital ones. But it was like this: you have a product brochure, and then you could unfold it to read it. Literally, what happened if they were digitized, then you could turn the page, click the mouse, the page turned. So that was the first generation of how products were sold online. But then Mr. Bezos kicked in with his Amazon. And Mr. Bezos learned us that to sell products online is a complete different user experience, what consumers appreciate. Similar things are happening right now. If you talk about infotainment, then Netflix is teaching us now what the most appreciated user experience is about. If I'm sitting on my couch at home and I want to be entertained, but as well get some relevance. So there are multiple miniseries now out there, which basically are informative but entertaining. So we said to ourselves, in the world we are living today, that won't change tomorrow, won't change in the coming years. So we will live in an era of less physical interaction. How should we? We still want to. We have our commitment to shape the future of chocolate indulgence together with our partners and experts. How should we kick off this journey? So we decided to introduce a platform, which is, by the way, on-demand available post the 28th, which will consist of, we start with 5 mini-series, and the 5 mini-series have 5 episodes. Could have been 6, could have been 4, but we decided 5 relevant content pieces. And people can binge-watch a mini-series which focuses upon a specific topic. It can be the topic, like, for example, mini-series 5, we call it 1-2-3 Go. That's all about the positive impact you can make the moment you upcycle basically what is used to be wasted. Now, in our world, caca fruit is massively wasted so far. So what is the impact we can make? Now, there are several topics, and from different perspectives, we reflect upon this challenge. So the format for the 28th, the post the 28th, will be that there's a mini series and there's several mini series available you can binge watch. But we thought, okay, still what is heavily appreciated is the active engagement and interaction and questions you might have as a customer or a prospect or whoever, an expert, that you can basically discuss this with somebody. So each of these mini-series will be hosted by an anchor who will be live in the studio, and the questions you can just raise, you can discuss with each other, with your peers in the industry, about a specific topic. So the 28th is therefore for us, it's the perfect hybrid model of Netflix meets live event. And we feel that is the way forward to communicate, not only now, but in the years to come, if we want to engage about relevant topics with the industry, to shape the industry.
And just coming on to this past year, as we were mentioning earlier, it has been such a challenging one for everybody. So how do you best sum up how Barry Callebaut has handled the pandemic?
Yeah, the first and foremost focus for us has been the safety and well-being of our own employees and teams. Because the moment our own employees and teams and the families feel safe and well, then they obviously can contribute as well to the ongoing supply of our ingredients to our customers. So if your people are well, your customers ultimately are well. So primary focus has been our own employees and their families. The second priority has been making sure that all our factories, 65 plus across the world, keep operating. And that implies, in some cases, a lot, because you can imagine the moment the pandemic hit Indonesia, well, normally the people in your factories travel with public transport to the factories, and if the government decides that there's no public transport overnight anymore, then you still need to make sure that your employees can get the opportunity to get to the factory. So you have overnight have to organize then your own transport system, make sure that there is sleeping accommodation and hotels available if they don't want to travel back and forth, to make sure that the factories can keep on running. So maintaining the supply to our customers, being part of the important food supply in the across the world, was then a second very important priority for ourselves.
Yes, and just moving on to areas of product focus there. At last year's ISM, we had the big topic of plant-based chocolates there. How is that coming along as far as Barry Callebaut is concerned?
Very important. So mini series 3 is about the garden party. And this is all about plant-based indulgence. And plant-based indulgences are not only related to indulgence, which, for example, makes use of to replace milk, but as well everything related to nuts. And as you know, we are the biggest supplier of nuts in Europe. And hence for us, nuts is a very important category as well to better introduce to our customers what are the benefits of nuts, not only from a texture and flavor perspective, but as well nutritionally. And there's a lot of, I think, a lot of knowledge to be gained in the role of nuts in the diet and the well-being of and the health of a consumer. So the garden party, plant-based, and we call it plant craft, because chocolate is ultimately about indulgence and pleasure. So I plant-based makes it very technical. I'd rather talk about plant craft indulgence and products. Plant crafted products are absolutely something which will be in the spotlight this year. Like basically the Gen Zest for Life, and living in the now and having fascinating, nice experiences in taste and appearance will keep on rocking. So we will launch on the 28th of April, the sister of the first Ruby R, Ruby 1, which is Ruby Intense, which is a more intense berry fruity flavor profile for Ruby chocolate. And like you know, there are thousands of different dark chocolates, milk chocolate, and white chocolates. Ruby being the fourth type of chocolate, and announced in September 2017. This is the moment now on April 28th that we will introduce the sister of Ruby, the first Ruby, which is the Ruby Intense. But not only Ruby Intense is something to drive hedonistic indulgence, caramel. You know, you are from the UK, you love caramel. But caramel is conquering the world now too, like you've seen with Magnum, the Magnum gold billionaire bar. It's I think it's a testimony to the appreciation of caramel across the world. So there. I think if you watch this mini series, Gen Zest for Life, you will see some new nice initiatives which are launched in Japan first. But they will travel the world, so make sure, I don't know if you intend to join, but on the 28th, that you watch the mini-series and the episode which is related to the lab of Japan, where there will be very nice ingredients which celebrate dark color, black color, to basically create a different appearance for chocolate indulgence.
Just related to that, I know a lot of your marketing has been based around the millennials and centennial generation of consumers, and their focus has largely been on health and well-being, as it has been for older generations as well. So does that factor still into your marketing in terms of how you're approaching developing new products at the moment?
Yeah, so I think, first of all, for the generation you're in, the younger generation is quite often aspirational to you. the moment you are young, the older generation is aspirational to you. That's an interesting thing. So what we have been focusing upon understanding Gen X and Gen Z particularly and primarily over the last years, because they make the mass market volume of the future. And if you don't understand them early enough, then you will be late with capturing their attention, and then they will ignore your category, basically. And that's the reason why we indeed came up with initiatives like Ruby, and now as well in September 19, we announced Whole Fruit Chocolate. By the way, Whole Fruit Chocolate will be the center point of attention for mini series 5, which is 1, 2, 3 go, because Whole Fruit Chocolate, I have here an example, is the fruit bar amongst the chocolate, the most delicious solution to fight climate change. Since it's upcycled, 70% of the fruit was used to be discarded as waste. Celebrated for its unique taste, fresh fruitiness. Now, that is ticking the box of taste, nutritiousness, because it contains 40% less sugar than the standard chocolate. And it upcycles something, so it's there for very good for the impact we make on the environment for the farmer who earns more, because they get revenues for something they did not get revenues for in the past, but moreover for the environmental, the nature footprint. That obviously is not only interesting chocolate for Gen Z or for Gen X, as well for the parents. What we are mindful about is that the diets, let's say the parents of Generation X, the healthy agers appreciate, is changing as well. And we are busy with it to understand this in more detail and what the impact of this could be for us and for chocolate. And we call this, they are looking for benefits which are related to food for health, where there are more active claims. And active claims substantiated by hardcore research, potentially even clinical studies.
And if I could just close on looking ahead to the rest of the year, what do you perceive are going to be the biggest challenges facing the industry as we try and get back to some kind of normality?
Chocolate indulgence, caring for personal environmental health, and actively addressing this attitude change of consumers, since they appreciate different things. They did already, but this is now due to COVID accelerated. So how do we act as an industry upon this? And how do we make sure that capital consumptions will grow? Because the most pleasurable proposition you consume ultimately is chocolate, what we know from a lot of people across the world. So how do we make sure it keeps on being that pleasurable, but potentially even more?
And I should say, and it sounds as if you have some very positive solutions there. So are you personally optimistic that things will improve in the coming months ahead?
Without doubt. Like we will surprise sooner or later. I won't tell how soon or how late. And like we've done with Ruby and with Whole Fruit Chocolate, our innovation pipeline is extremely exciting. I'm very positive about the future and the tools we will have together with our customers to shape chocolate indulgence, which is extremely appreciated by the consumers of the brands and of the artisans.